Hey there. Welcome to my playthrough of Shadowrun Crossfire. I'm going to take you through a three-mission mini-campaign that I made up, about 5 minutes ago, in order to show you how the game is played and also how the missions vary and offer some nice variability. This is a game that I got about a month ago, and it has skyrocketed to the top of my games that I want to play and my preferred solitaire games. I'm actually playing through a campaign that I've kind of made up on my own that I'm making up as I go, with two runners, excuse me. And on that note, I'd like to say that I am normally someone who doesn't like to play two-handed. I like to have one character that I identify with and like one hand of cards to manage, but I'm finding it is not a problem here whatsoever because you generally have a small hand of cards and a small deck in this game. It's not like a massive deck that you kind of have to track your cards like you do in some other deck builders. So just want to say, if there's anyone else out there like me, don't be afraid of playing this two-handed. You really don't want to play this game with one runner. You need a minimum of two for a lot of the card effects. And as difficult as this game is, you need those card effects. So I've selected three missions that I'm going to string together in a mini campaign. And I'm going to play them once each, or maybe more. I'm not exactly sure. And we'll see how many times I play each one and how many points I get and kind of make up a score. But the idea is to show you all how it's played. So with that said, let me show you which three I've selected and then we can go ahead and get started. Okay, before I get started, I should mention that I have the Character Pack 1 and the High Caliber Ops expansions mixed in. So I have some new missions and there are going to be a lot of new cards. Some of them will be multicolored that come with the High Caliber Ops expansion, which I highly, highly, highly recommend. If you have this game or thinking about getting it, spend the $15 and get the High Caliber Ops. I love a lot of great new content. I mean, in a card game, more cards is always better, right? Okay, so I honestly don't remember where these are from. This might be from High Caliber Ops. This is from the base game, and I think that might be from the base game. But the point is, I've selected these as the mini campaign I'm doing here. The story I've made up is against the Ancients. The Ancients are a group of an elf gang, and we are hired by Mr. Johnson to go in and pick something up, and we are betrayed to this elf gang, so they pursue us. First, we have to fight our way out of it, then they pursue us in the Crossfire mission, and then it turns out they were double-crossed, and then some other rival gangs show up, and it becomes a free fire for all, and we have to fight our way out of that. So that's the story I've made up for the campaign. Mechanically, the way this works is if you win this one, you could get two karma points and then three and three. So my plan is to play them all, and a perfect score would be three attempts and eight points. Not exactly sure how I'm going to do this. I might play one, and if I fail, maybe I'll give it one more shot, or maybe I'll just play it once and move on. I'm not exactly sure. I want to see how this goes. So I'm going to play them, obviously at least once, and just going to count up my attempts and what my final score is, and see how I do. I'm playing two characters. I'm playing this troll who I've named Taga. He starts up here at 7 health. He gets three starting cards. When you play with only two runners, they get a primary and a secondary role. So his primary role is the Decker, and his secondary role is the Street Samurai. That's significant for two things. Number one is you get one more starting Nuyen than you normally would, so you can see he's got three instead of two. And secondly, when card effects refer to the Street Samurai, then we know that they'll be referring to Taga, okay? Over here we have Ona, the Human Mage, same deal. Primary mage, secondary face, one extra Nuyen, starting health is five. Like all missions I've seen so far, this mission has three scenes that we have to complete in order to win. The first one, we're gonna face obstacles equal to the number of runners, and then scene two, it's runners plus one, and scene three, it's runners plus two, okay? I'm gonna pull. We've got the normal obstacle levels and the hard. We also have a set of elf obstacles from the normal. So these are all the elf ones that comprise the Ancients deck. So that's the rival elf gang that we got to deal with. We pull
Obstacles equal to the crossfire level. If you're not familiar, the crossfire level is the number of crossfire cards in the discard pile. This will be my discard pile, so there's obviously none. So then, per the mission rules here, I need to pull two from the Ancients deck. All right, and then if I need more, I pull from the normal. But right now, I'm going to pull two, because that's what we need for the first scene. The first one's going to go up facing the runner that matches the color, and then clockwise. So this is red, so this will go over to Ona, since she is the face roll back up. When this is defeated, set it aside. When an elf or sixth world is flipped up, we deal a level of damage. All right, that will come in handy, I'm sure. And then this one goes clockwise over to Taga, and this is an ancient sentry. No effect, that's just thematic text. So they each have one in front of them, and they each of these do two. Okay, lastly, I just want to mention that normally a round of crossfire, you start with drawing a crossfire card, and then you take a turn with, you know, one runner, then another runner, and then you pull a crossfire card. As a mitigation for having only two runners, we don't have to draw a crossfire card until round three, okay? So I don't have to worry about that. All right, so first turn, this is what our troll has here. He can't finish this off, so he's going to end up taking two damage, but he can start it off with the blue. And then looking over here at this one, this needs to be started with a gun, which he has, and which she does not have in her hand. So I'm thinking of having him play those two cards, holding this back. He'll play the blue over to this obstacle, and then the black over to that one, and begin doing damage on each of these. Okay. So now in the assigned damage phase, he needs to take two from this, and then he gets to draw two cards. Remember, if you have three or fewer cards in hand, then you get to draw two. Ugh, so he's got a handful of green. So looking at next turn, oh crap, he needs a red, and he didn't pull one. He's going to end up taking two damage next turn as well, because unfortunately there are no red for sale here. He's got three. The only thing he can afford is this or this. Although I guess on her turn, this is what she has. She could play three and a red over to his, because she can't knock hers out on her turn anyway. Okay, so this is the kind of coordination you have to do between runners. You definitely got to help each other out. So I think what I'm going to have him do is, if she's going to knock it out on his turn, So when it comes back around to him, this won't be here, and he'll have three cards. He won't be able to play on this because this needs a fourth. So maybe I'll have him buy the whip, and he'll be able to play four onto that. Yeah, that's not bad. And then on her turn, if she buys this card, which has a red and a blue, then she'll be able to do the red and the blue. These are the kind of puzzles that you either find fun and love this game or not. I love it. So, all right, I'm going to have him buy the whip for two, which reveals lightning bolt. Ooh, another good spell. These two are super awesome. Okay, so he drew cards. He already took damage. So now it's her turn. Yeah, she's going to go ahead and finish his obstacle off by playing three and a red. And knock that out. That's pretty cool. So since she knocks it out, she gets three of the five, and he gets two of the five. Okay. If you're not familiar, that's the Nuyen benefit for knocking something out. She is then going to take two damage from this thing over here. So two, and now she can go shopping and The plan was to have her buy Heart of the Team, but let me double check now if she got paid and has more money. She has 6 and can buy this Lightning Bolt, which is awesome. It deals 2 levels. But I'm tempted to have her buy the Heart of the Team still, because the benefit, the effect of the card is she discards a card, and if it's a red card, she chooses a runner, that runner draws a card. If it's a spell card, a blue card, that runner heals. She's got a bunch of blue in her deck. That could be pretty helpful in terms of getting some healing, although Lightning Bolt is so awesome. But I'm going to go ahead and have her buy this one for that healing effect. I hope I don't regret that. And then she's got 2 left over, and I think she'll save her money. Hopefully we'll get her that Lightning Bolt next. And actually, I forgot to draw cards before she purchased, so she drew these 2. So by process of elimination, looking at what's in her discard and what's in her hand, I know that that's the card that's left. So I know that when I play this, she's going to end up discarding a spell card and get a point of healing. So it's a guaranteed healing point, so I am going to go ahead and do that. Okay, that ends round 1. We go to round 2, still don't have to bother with these nasty things, and our troll dude plays 4 points of whatever to affect this guy right here and knock that up. He doesn't take any damage because he doesn't have any obstacles in front of him. So then he gets to draw 2 cards and he can go shopping. He's got 3. But this is one of those moments where you have to learn not to purchase, because even though he has 3 and he could, you know, theoretically buy just that, it looks like. But even if he could, even if he had more choices, she's about to knock this out and he's going to get paid. And as you will see, that's going to end a scene because there will be no obstacles. And when a scene ends, you get an instant purchase. So he might as well wait till he gets paid from this and get that purchase rather than purchase for 3, okay? So that's one of the things when I first started the game, you know, it's not obvious that that's going to happen until you've played it. All right, so on her turn, she's going to go ahead and play Heart of the Team, which says discard a card. We knew it was a blue. She's going to give herself the healing point. And then the blue and the red are going to knock this out. So I got to remember to set this aside. Next time an elf or 6th world obstacle comes up, we're going to deal that damage. I'm going to put it there to remind myself, because I have a hard time remembering that sometimes. All right. So first we finish her turn, and then we reset the scene. She takes no damage. She draws 2 cards. So let me shuffle. I forgot to pay them. They each get paid 2. Okay, and now she can go shopping. Ah, crap, she's got 5. Just 1 shy of getting the Lightning Bolt. So I think I'm gonna have her get Shatter instead. She can afford that. It deals 1 level of damage and also has an assist ability. And it adds another spell card to her deck for that, that Heart of the Team card that she just played. All right, so we'll do that for 4. And that reveals cards, when they're purchased, are immediately replaced. So then you can keep purchasing if you want, if you have the money. But she doesn't have the money, so she's going to stop there. All right, so now the scene ends. 2 things happen. 1 is each runner heals a point, so I'm going to move them up each a point. If there were a crossfire card in play, it would get removed, not even discarded, removed. So that's a benefit, because you don't want crossfire cards in your discard, as you'll see. then starting with the runner to the left of the runner who ended the scene, she ended it, so we look over to Taga. He gets to purchase 1 card at this point. So now he's got 5 instead of 3. And let's see what he might want. Well, I think I'm going to have him buy Crazy Katie's auto gun. He picked up the whip, which has a benefit if you've played another weapon card on your turn. So getting more weapon cards in his deck seems like a good thing. Now, this is a difficult part of the game, and I haven't found any way around it, which is buying blind. We're about to reset the scene. We're about to get 3 obstacles now. I don't know what he's going to need. He might need something else. He might need more red, which would mean buying that card. instead. But so this is tough because sometimes you can buy something without realizing, or you can hold back and not buy something, but then that's really dangerous. So I'm going to have him buy this and trust that that's going to work out. So let's immediately replace this. Okay, that now ends the scene. We go to the top of the third. We have to draw a crossfire. We have to reset the scene. All right, so I'm drawing a crossfire again. The crossfire level is zero. So I'm going to pull two from the Ancients deck, and then I need one more, and that's going to come from the normal. So again, it's going to go to the color of the runner, black, which is our troll dude, because he's the street samurai backup. So this is going to go over to here. This only takes effect when the crossfire level is three, when there's three crossfire cards in the discard pile, so I can ignore this for now. I hope I remember that. If that takes effect, it's a very easy thing to forget as you're playing because it doesn't take effect immediately. All right. When an elf world is flipped up, deal one level of damage. So I'm going to knock out that first gun. Okay, now I can discard this because we've used it. So now the next one's going to go over to her because it always goes clockwise from there. When this attacks, deal one level of damage to an orc or troll obstacle. There are no orc or trolls. If you are an orc or troll, it has lethal. She's not. She's a human, so that won't take effect. Lethal, real quick rules. Whenever you take damage, if you're here and you take like three damage, you don't go one, two, three. You go one, two, and you stop at staggered. Then you have one more turn to either get healed, or if you take damage, you go critical. That card would have you just go one, two, three straight down. So that can be kind of nasty. Does not take effect, though, because she's not an orc or troll. All right, now we need one more. That's right. So I'm pulling one more, and this is going to go back over to him because it's clockwise. Choose a runner. That runner takes a damage. All right, well, I guess it'll be our troll dude since he was a little healthier. Okay, now I've got to flip the first crossfire card of the game. All right, this here refers to if there are that many cards in the crossfire discard pile. There aren't, so that's not going to take effect. This takes effect. Each dwarf and elf obstacle heals a level. Well, it doesn't apply. The attack strength of each dwarf and elf is increased by plus one. Oh, that sucks. Oh, that really sucks because we have two elves. We have one here, and then there's this one here in front of her. Eesh, that was not a good card to pull. Okay, I just had to pause and think about stuff. And here's where I'm really super happy that I had her buy this card because it has this assist ability, right? So she can play this on his turn and it will give a blue and anything damage, okay? Or colorless, whatever. That's gonna help a ton. So she's gonna play that, all right? He's gonna play Crazy Katie, which I'm really glad he purchased because he needs all of that. And he's gonna play this. Now, as a reminder, cards are played against an obstacle. Damage cannot be split between cards, so I couldn't apply this to this and then this to this, okay? All damage has to go against one obstacle. However, I can spend the points differently. I don't have to spend these in any sort of order. I don't have to finish this card before I use this. So I could do the black and then the red, and then the black and then this and then these, those kinds of things. In fact, what I do sometimes to help myself figure things out is use colored dice. So let me show you what that is. Okay, so I'm getting a red here. I'm getting two black. I'm getting three white colorless. Okay, from here. And then at the bottom of this, the assist, it's providing a blue and then two more white. So I have all of these to spend. And like I said, as long as they're going against the same obstacle, I can spend them in any order that I want. So I can spend four of these to take that out. I can spend the red to take that out. And then I have four left and I only need three. So one is wasted, but there's nothing to be done about that. That helps a lot because this was gonna hit him for two. Okay, so let me put that over here and clean up. All right, before I draw cards, he's got to take one damage from this. So he draws cards and he can go shopping for four. This is a nice card, coordinated attack. Hang on a second. Yeah, and you know what? He needs red too, because he's got this guy in front of him with two red. So he's gonna buy this for four. I like that one too. Okay. So now let's come over here, and I'm remembering that each elf obstacle is plus one, but as it turns out, she's going to be able to handle this by playing a blue, these two, and a gun. So didn't that just work out nice? So that will knock this guy out. She gets paid two. He gets paid two. All right. She doesn't take any damage. She has to finish her turn. Oh, scene's not over. We have one more obstacle yet. All right, so she draws two cards, and then for six, I'm gonna have her buy the lightning bolt, and she did play a spell, so she can buy it. This deals two consecutive levels of damage to an obstacle. That's pretty nice. On the downside is she's got a hand of only blue, and then this. All right, that ends that round. So now this goes into the crossfire discard pile, and this is what starts to build these up. So we flip around and we've got, all right, so we're not at three yet. At the start of each turn, the current runner randomly discards a card. Then for each of their rolls, which are two, right, because they have a primary and a backup, that runner can return a card from their discard to their hand that has, oh man, he doesn't have anything in his discard. Ugh. Okay, so he has to randomly discard a card. Okay. Oh, but he'll have this in his discard now. Okay. Then for each of the rolls, that runner can return a card from the discard to their hand that has a color that matches that roll. Okay, so he's... All right, he's red and black, and he discarded this randomly. So he can return this. unfortunately, there's nothing else in his discard at this point, so it really had a null effect for him. Okay, so let's put these back. Okay, this is the last obstacle we've got to deal with, and coordinated attack is going to come in extremely handy here. So he's going to play coordinated attack, choose another runner, that runner draws a card and plays a card. So she draws a card. But the one that she wants to play, it doesn't have to be the one that she drew. She's going to play Lightning Bolt, okay? Deal two consecutive levels. Then he's going to play, back up here. He's going to play these three, all right? So, and remember, since everything is happening at once, we can do these in order. Now, the lightning bolt says deal two consecutive levels, so I'm gonna have to, whatever I choose here is gonna have to be consecutive. But check this out. These three will do this. Lightning bolt will hit and do two consecutive, and then the red will do the last, and that is wasted. But boom, knocks that out with a little help from the coordinated attack, bringing in the lightning bolt. All right, let me clean up. So he draws two, and he can go shopping. And again, this is really tough. We're about to go into the final scene. We're gonna have four obstacles, two per runner, and I don't know what he's gonna need, but I think he's gonna need something. I'm gonna have him buy Press the Advantage. That's a pretty neat card. He can reveal cards from his deck and pick up some extra cards. I'll show you. So that was five, which is what he had. All right, now that his turn ends and there are no obstacles in front of a runner, the scene ends. So this is where we get this advantage. This goes away, doesn't go into here. Each runner heals one. Okay, well, she's doing really well this game. And then starting with the runner to the left, so her, she can purchase something. You know, I'm gonna, okay, I think I'm gonna have her buy this for four. The assist ability is to cancel the abilities on one obstacle for the rest of the game. We're about to pull out four new obstacles. There very well might be something on there that we hate. Unfortunately, she can't play it on her turn because it's an assist ability. So she'll have to wait till Taga's turn. But I'm thinking that might be a good thing for her to do. Okay, so now I need to reset the scene and have her take her turn. There's one card in the crossfire discard, so I need to pull four obstacles. I'm going to pull one difficult, since there's one card here, then two from the Ancients deck, per the special rules of this mission, and then the fourth one will be a normal one. So here we go. It's green, so it'll go to him. Flipped, the runner with the most HP draws two cards and takes two damage. On ties, each of them. Oh, that just sucks. Because they both actually have five. Okay, so they both go down to three. Eesh, and they both draw two cards. Let me do that. Okay. She didn't get anything exciting, but he did, so maybe that'll help. So that was the difficult. Now two from the Ancients, so this goes to her clockwise. Ancients Ganger, no real effect there. This goes back to him. Exiled Prince, the union value of each other obstacle is increased by plus one. All right, so that only affects the two that are in play at the time that that's flipped. So this gets plus one, and this gets a plus one. Okay. So that's those two, and then this one goes back to her, and it's a normal sudden fate. All right, so buying that back door was really dumb. That was dumb. That's not going to help us. Although it does provide a green, and I see a fair amount of green symbols out here, so maybe that'll help. All right, she's got... They each have three health. Three health left, and she's got 3 points of damage coming at her. She has to take out at least one of these or else she's going to stagger. The good news is that stupid crossfire card that, or that obstacle that had us each take two damage also had them draw two cards. So they do both have a lot of cards. So actually, backdoor is going to come in handy after I just criticized myself for taking it. Actually, first she's going to play Heart of the Team. And remember, you can reapply cards, so I don't necessarily need to declare which obstacle it's going towards. I'm just going to kind of play it in a general sense. Discard the top card of your deck. Come on, spell. It's red. If it's a skill card, which is what this is, choose a runner. That runner draws a card. I think I'm going to have her choose herself. Oh, and she just drew Shatter. Oh, this changes everything. Deal one level of damage to an obstacle. That was an incredibly lucky pull. And drawing those two cards with that obstacle has also been incredibly fortuitous. So check this out. Like I said, she's got a bunch of cards in hand from drawing the extra cards and then also playing this, which drew an extra card. So she can play the blue on Heart of the Team and then the red and these two blue for three whatever. So blue and three whatever, and then Shatter, deal one level of damage to an obstacle, and that'll knock out the Ancients Ganger. Then she's not done. She plays these and does two anything and a blue, which will handle, okay, move this up here, handle this here, and then the two green will knock that out, and she just knocked out both of these with one huge turn. That was pretty cool. So let me clean this up and pay everybody. A nice clear table. I like to see that. She drew two cards, obviously didn't take any damage, and she can go shopping for five. So let's take a look at what we've got left here and what she can do. Anything with an assist ability would be good, and I don't see anything with an assist ability out here to help. So, looking at her hand, she has a blue and a black. I'm thinking maybe she should pick up a red to maybe help out. Yeah, it's not obvious to me what she should buy, so I'm just going to have her buy bartering because it provides two symbols. It only costs three. Okay. And then, some awesome cards here, but I just didn't get enough money to buy them this game. I don't know what's going to happen because Taga has pressed the advantage, so he's going to be able to pull some cards from his deck. I don't know what he's going to get, so I don't know if, you know, she needs to help out with this or if she needs to help out with something else, but she doesn't have a lot of great choices here because of the high price cards in the market. All right. That ends her turn, so now we start a new round, and we're going to pull a Crossfire card. All right, here we go. And this does take effect because we have one card in the Crossfire discard. Oh boy. First of all, each runner heals half of the HP they've lost rounded up, and then when this goes into the discard, each runner takes two damage. Okay. All right, so he's 7 to 3 is 4. He heals half that, so he goes up to 5. And she's at 3. 5 to 3 is 2, and she heals half that. She goes up to 4. So they're each going to take 2. That's not a huge problem right now. She's going to net out worse because she gained 1. She's going to lose 2, and he's going to break even. All right, not the worst thing in the world. So now, let's see what we can do here. He's going to play Press the Advantage. He gets to reveal cards from the top of his deck until he gets a card of the same color of one that he pulled. So he pulled a green. Please don't pull a green. He pulled a red, okay? So the next time he pulls a color that he already has, he has to stop. I've got to shuffle. Third card, all right, it's a green. So he has to stop here. That goes back. He doesn't get that one, but he gets these two. So still, he pulled two cards out of his discard. Should be able to take out at least one of these right now, so let's see what makes sense. Okay, so he's played Press the Advantage, so I want to make use of that symbol. So I was looking at this one, but he can't finish this off because it's got a blue. He can finish this off, so let's have him do that. Crazy Katie's auto gun is 5 points of damage. All right, this red will be 6 points of damage, so that is going to go towards that. Then he can play green, right, which is going to move that up to here. Then he can play this red to get that there, and then he can play this gun to get that there. So 5, 6, green, 1, black, and we'll knock this out at least. I think we're going to have a little bit of a hard time on this one. All right. I think that makes sense. That takes out, he won't take as much damage. So that knocks this guy out. This was one of those ones that had an extra on it, so it's 4, so they each get paid 2 each. All right. These go into his discard. He takes 1 point of damage for this, draws 2 cards, and then he can go shopping, and he's got some money. Oh, he's one shy of buying one of these awesome ones. He's got 7. That's 8. These two are 9. A red. He doesn't have a blue. Oh, this is going to be annoying. He doesn't have a blue. Icon grab. If you played another hacking card during this turn, you can get a symbol of your choice. And he has a hacking card in his hand, so, you know, this is a case where, like, the best card isn't always the best card. This lowly little 2 guy gives us some flexibility. All right, he still has 5 left. Talk about needing blue. Death Touch. That could come in handy. No, I think he's going to get the blue with Icon Grab. So I think he's going to pick up this one, if you played another hacking card and another weapon, he has a hacking card and a weapon, so he's going to be doing that, then X equals the strength of each obstacle. So this is a 1, so at least that X will be worth 1. This would be worth the number of spell cards revealed. He doesn't have a lot of spell cards. It'd very well be 0. This is a guaranteed 1. So he will buy that for 4, and that'll end his turn. He took his damage. He went shopping. All right, so on her turn, she can play... Let me back this up here. She can play this gun to get it started, and then she can play this and this. So the blue and the 1 will go as anything, so it's going to be black, and then 2 of anything, and then the red. And then all he needs to do is finish those 2 off. But then again, you never know what the Crossfire deck has in store for you. So she needs to shuffle and draw cards. She doesn't take damage, and then she can go shopping. So let's think about it. Oh, there's her Lightning Bolt. It was the last card in her deck. All right, she drew that. And then for 4, she'll buy Death Touch. I mean, the only thing I'm really considering right now is that some of these Crossfire cards will say, hey, reveal another obstacle, and you thought you were just about done, you were just about to kill something and end the game, and another obstacle comes out. So I think she's going to buy this for 4, okay, just in case. All right, now that ends the round. This goes into the discard pile, and the bomb effect happens. When this goes into the discard, each runner takes 2 damage. She's down to 1, and he's down to 2. So it's all about this card right here. The current runner can only apply damage to obstacles facing them or a runner who's played. Ah, fine. Game. Okay. Good, good, good. So he can play, this, and then this, which says if you've played another hacking card, then it'll give you a wild. So he'll choose a blue, and he'll do boom, boom, and kill the exiled prince and escape momentarily from the ancients. Okay. Okay. Yeah, we were sitting pretty there by the end. So that is a successful run of it, although we were down to... 2 health over here and just 1 over here, so I wouldn't have wanted to pull any new obstacles. Per the rules, we get all of 2 karma, which tells me that this isn't the hardest mission, because I think the standard seems to be 3. But hey, a win is a win. So, okay, this is not my first attempt at doing a video. Sometimes I do a video, and then when I edit it and rewatch it, I realized I did something wrong. I had a previous playthrough where I sort of did one of these where I had this like this, and then I was adjusting something, and I kind of did this and inadvertently bumped that up a level, and I was like, oh, I can't post that. It was cheating. So I'm going to go watch this, and assuming I don't find any major screw-ups, I'll go ahead and post it, and that'll be the first mission, and then our intrepid heroes here, Taga and Ona, will attempt to flee without getting caught in the crossfire.